Hi, my name is Doina, and I am thrilled to be here today and speak to a woman I truly admire, Marie-Claire Daveau, about the future of sustainability in fashion. Let's go.
Hello, Doina. I'm very happy to welcome you in Kering headquarters in Paris and to have this conversation with you about sustainability and fashion. I'm sure that we will have a great conversation. So very happy to welcome you.
Thank you for having me. It's a true honor. And I love you and aspire to be a person like you. So it's very special for me to chat with you today.
So my first question will be, what does sustainability or sustainable fashion mean to you?
It's the million dollar question, right? I think there are so many ways to answer this and I can go into so many details, but I think sustainability as a whole, and this is where fashion ties into it for me, and it might be a philosophical kind of approach, but it's more or less us not being the last generations on this planet and the future generations also being able to survive on this planet and be able to enjoy nature and life as we know it. And this is where, you know, the little technical parts of fashion sustainability and any other parts of sustainability come in, where we have to work towards making better choices and, you know, produce things better and pollute less. And I'm curious now that we're speaking about this, and like I said, you know, I admire you so much and I think you're a true female force to aspire to. Tell us, have you always been interested in sustainability? Have you always worked in sustainability?
So first, you put a lot of pressure on my shoulders. So I grew up in Brittany, and I have always been sensitive to the sea, to the forest, and all the landscape around me. And I think my sensitivity to our planet, but also to animal welfare, goes back to my childhood and also the way that I was educated by my family, my mother especially. And when I was a teenager, I was working in an association, in an NGO dedicated to animal welfare, so it was from many, many years a passion, and after I decided to study biology, to become an engineer, perhaps also to try to understand how the things work and how we can be sure to put something realistic to transform the world and to protect our planet. So it was really something very important for me. After I joined the public sector, because at the beginning I was a civil servant, I worked in several ministries, but always in sustainability and in ecology. I joined Kering in 2012, so now more than 10 years. And now I am in charge, as you know, of sustainability, but also institutional affairs. And if I am very honest with you, during all my past, during all my career, ecology and animals were really the kind of fil rouge of my passion. So it's really something that I don't remember when really it started, perhaps as a baby. No, I'm joking, okay? But I will ask you also the question, when and how did you decide really to be involved in sustainability, on the environmental issue, and really to dedicate your time as you are doing today?
I love what you said, that you started from animal welfare, and I feel like within sustainability, just like probably every other sort of social topic, you have to start from a passion. And whilst you might care for sustainability as an overall issue, but I think it does start from one passion. For you, it was animals. For me, it was plastic. Hence now I'm actually an ambassador for No More Plastic. So actually, it was interesting because I don't know, it was probably 6-7 years ago, we were seeing all the news about plastic pollution and, you know, the seas being filled with plastic and microplastics. But the problem with plastic is it's invisible, in a sense, microplastics and the pollution of plastic. So when you hear, oh, there's plastic pollution, you look around yourself and think, oh, I can't see any plastic on the ground, so, you know, maybe it's not as bad. But I went on a holiday to Bali, actually, which, you know, is a paradise on earth. But when I got there, I was actually heartbroken, because for as beautiful as it was, I saw the reality of the plastic pollution there, which, you know, as you know, especially for a very long time, a lot of the European countries, etc., were exporting its plastic to Southeast Asia. So you could really see that overflowing plastic there. And for the first time, I went on these pristine beaches, and suddenly I realized they're filled with plastic, and the problem became visible. It wasn't just a theory anymore, or, you know, a piece of news in some article. And that's why my passion in sustainability started with plastic. But, you know, you also said what I thought was interesting. When you were a teenager, you kind of were an activist and participated in NGOs, and then you went in to find more real ways to bring change. And I think I had a little bit of the same situation, because often you find yourself almost like a dreamer. Maybe you approach sustainability from this very naive, almost like very courageous.
You want to change the world.
Exactly. And you think it's so easy. Why don't they just do this? But in reality, and now having consulted as well and being behind closed doors, it's not so easy. You can't just, you know, change everything so easily. And this is where I wanted to ask you. Tell me about some of the challenges that you've encountered as Chief Sustainability Officer, and what were the easier challenges, and which ones did you find harder to kind of overcome?
To jump on what you said a few seconds ago, I think we can't change the world alone, but we can bring something to contribute to change the world and to change the paradigm. So to answer your question first, I like in English the word challenges. It's really more positive in English than in French. After, because you are really involved in sustainability, you know that sustainability, it's really a long journey. It's the same thing for a public organization and for a private company. It's quite difficult. But if I am, again, very transparent with you, I think the first step when we are speaking about a sustainability journey, it's really to be able to measure your environmental footprint. Because you are able to change the things only if you know where you are exactly and where your impacts are coming from. So that's why inside Caring, now more than 10 years ago, we created a specific tool called our Environmental Profit and Loss Account. It's a tool that supports us to measure our environmental footprint, not only in our own operations, but also in our entire supply chain. And it was really interesting because with these results, we were able to understand that nearly 90% of our environmental footprint were linked with our supply chain. So it means outside our legal boundaries. And based on this, we decided to create, and we continue to do that every year, to implement specific programs. So, for example, link with cashmere, link with wool in New Zealand, leather in France or in Italy. So after putting in place tanning processes without heavy metals, to push upcycling, recycling. So really, to dedicate some specific programs and, of course, to implement them. And inside Caring, we are very lucky and very proud because our chairman and CEO, François-Henri Pinault, put now many years ago sustainability at the heart of the strategy. And he has a clear vision about not only the financial results, but also the non-financial results, if I can say in this way. But come back to you now. I have prepared some questions, so I have to ask you the question. So, what about you? As an influencer, you have a very large community. You are also speaking on social media and different kind of things. I really think that you have a power. You have also a responsibility to share your commitment in sustainability and really to push people to move their behavior. Have you the feeling that your followers, people who are looking at what you are doing, they are interesting in the sustainable fashion and the ecosystem linked with sustainable fashion?
Yes and no. I mean, honestly, on some more hopeful days, I would say yes. And I think that's, again, that's the idealistic part of myself, that I want to see people being interested in that. But I think the reality is more times people aren't necessarily interested, and not because they don't care about it. I think it's just, it's come to a point where people feel like they're powerless as individuals, because say you're making these little change in your life and then you see, I don't know, big polluters, huge company, or you know, countries trying to create artificial climates where they shouldn't be, to create certain experiences, etc. And with that, they leave such a huge carbon footprint. So I think people get tired of bearing the responsibility on their shoulders, and I have noticed that, because often you'll see them hopeful, and sometimes they just say, you know, why me? Why aren't the big companies taking that hit? Why aren't they doing more to change the situation? Why should I be the little individual changing my life? So, and then often, obviously, when you talk about sustainability products, as you know, it, more often than not, they do end up being a more expensive option, just because, you know, it involves human rights being respected, it involves a more ethical supply chain, et cetera, et cetera. So, not everyone can make that sacrifice in their wallet to pay a premium for a more sustainable product. And that is another side of sustainability that I hope in time, you know, will slightly change, so it becomes more democratized and inclusive. And I love what you said before, you know, that sustainability is a journey, because that's how I approach it. Because, I mean, obviously I work in fashion, so it's hypocritical of me to be, you know, oh, let's be sustainable, because fashion is one of the most polluting industries in the world. So the reality is, I think in sustainability and just in life to life, we are all slightly hypocrites, right? Because we say one thing, but in reality, we can't always follow through. But I like to call it a sustainability journey, because I feel like that feels more authentic to people. And I like what you also said about identifying where the problems were in the company and fixing them, because I think it takes a lot of courage to go out and say, actually, this was the problem, this is how we're fixing it. And you know, it's so easy, and we can see it, and that's where a lot of greenwashing happens. A lot of companies will just shift the blame onto the suppliers and say, oh, it's not our fault, it's outside our hands, it's the supplier's fault. So how do you deal with greenwashing and communicating your message and actually getting the message across in an authentic way?
At the level of caring, in link with our strategy for 2025, we decided that every 3 years, we give an overview with a lot of transparency about where we are. I think for a company, to do greenwashing, it's very dangerous. Because if you say something that you are not able to implement, or you do the opposite, it's also very dangerous on a reputation point of view, because now, perhaps not immediately, but a few weeks after, few months after, perhaps few years after, people will know the reality. And you can destroy very quickly the brand equity. So I think greenwashing is very dangerous. And in France, we have a specific now regulation that really is very interesting, because it gives a framework also to how to communicate when we are speaking about the environmental side, about what we are doing for climate change. And I think it's really a very important way to work, keeping in mind the communication side.
Yeah, I think the EU is also bringing an EU-wide regulation on greenwashing.
Yes, yes, yes. But in France, it's really a regulation, so the companies have really to apply. It's not soft law, it's really hard law for the company. And I think it can be also very inspiring in Europe or for other companies. It's not a Bible, I am not saying that, yeah. But it's very interesting to have in mind also, because sometimes, above all, on the environmental side, it's quite technical. So you try to have a great communication, but you don't go into details. Yeah. So you have to find really the right equilibrium between saying the truth, without being too much technical, so people don't want to read or don't want to listen what you are saying. So
And even I've noticed with the regulations also, it's interesting because that's a journey as well, because you'll often see, you know, governments trying to keep up, but as it's such a still evolving topic, they always have to change how they measure impacts, how they measure carbon footprint. So it's interesting to even watch how regulations in themselves change depending on, you know, what comes out, what science comes out, or maybe what NGOs goes and lobby those laws to, you know, maybe promote an even more intense law. So that even in governments, people are still trying to only just work it out. So it's definitely an always moving, always changing field.
That's why when we are thinking about the issue of our century and the most important, we were speaking about climate change, biodiversity, we can't do anything without regulation. So fully agree with you that regulation have to be adapted, and regulation is changing. And after, as a global company, we are very conscious that we have our part of responsibility, but it's very important also to work hand in hand with the public sector, so not only with the French authorities, but also with the European authorities, and more globally, as soon as we can bring something, the best practices, for example, in one country, it's very important, because again, if we want to change a paradigm, we need really public sector and private sector working together. I don't say that because I come from the public sector, I'm really convinced by that.
No, but it's definitely true, and you especially having an experience in both, you can really see that. But you know what I also find interesting with greenwashing on my side, just because I like observing how audiences respond to different messaging, especially around sustainability. And what I find sad is that because of so many fast fashion brands that have associated themselves so heavily with sustainability in a very vague manner and really promoted this greenwashing notion, now the consumer is actually quite reluctant to believe anything. And I'll often see that a brand that genuinely is doing things right and trying to do better genuinely, and the consumer won't necessarily believe it because they're used to the fact that almost any sustainability messaging out there is not an honest one. So it's definitely a very interesting and dangerous territory to navigate.
That's why humility and transparency, you see how much it's important, because transparency, it's not only to say everything is perfect and we are the best in the world. It's really also to show the progresses and the difficulties you meet. So I think it's, again, it's a question of equilibrium, but yes, it's true that the consumer and also something very interesting is the fact that the consumers, and not only the Gen Z and the millennials, they are also asking more and more questions to understand what is happening, where the raw materials are coming from, which kind of, chemical products we have used, what we are doing for the upcycling and things like that. So they are also more and more involved, and they push the brands to be more vocal and to give more explanations about what they are implementing and above all how they are implementing. So it's great. But you are also a sustainable consultant, and you are also, and congratulations for that, an ambassador for No More Plastic, which is a great NGO. We were speaking about climate change, biodiversity, but of course plastic, it's one of the most important also issue when we think about the oceans. Can you share with me a little bit the big picture, where you see also the challenges, perhaps key figures, that it will be very interesting?
With plastic, just to give a bit of perspective, we produce over 460 million tons of plastic a year, and it's actually expected to grow to 600 million tons by 2030. So our obsession with plastic is truly not just an environmental crisis, but a health crisis at this point. And I think this is where plastic is interesting, because most of the other types of pollution you can see, even air pollution, you can see through certain days of smog in your big city. But plastic pollution, like we were saying before, especially microplastics, is invisible. And it has been shown that we have microplastics inside us, and they're polluting our organs, they're a big endocrine disruptor. And just to show people how present plastic is in our lives, for instance, one of the most toxic types of plastics you'll find in teething circles for babies. So you think of it, these little babies using these teething circles that they actually grind on are leaking one of the most dangerous plastics out there. So plastic for me really is the epidemic of the 21st century, and I hope that in the future we can rely less and less on plastic. But, you know, plastic to the side and the more, the sadder kind of information aside, I am very curious to learn, do you see any interesting innovations in the future of fashion? Maybe you want to give us something positive we can look forward to.
Alors, first, when you are working in sustainability, you have to be very optimistic, because to change the world, you have, as I told at the beginning, you need some energy, so you have to be optimistic. So innovation, it's really a key part of our sustainability journey. And only to give you an order of magnitude, today, between the corporate and our brands inside the Kering Group, we are working with more than 120 startups.
Wow.
They are all working between sustainability and innovation. So, from a raw materials point of view, for example, we are working with Vitrolabs, which is a startup very interesting. They try really to make leather in lab. So, of course, today, they are making research, but one day I'm sure that we will be able to use this kind of new raw materials. We are also working with startups. They are putting in place a system to do eco-dyeing with microorganisms. We are working with startups really to put at scale upcycling, recycling. And you know, one of the key topics when we are speaking above all about recycling, it's really linked with the first step, dismantling. So one of the topics, it's first, you have to find innovations. Secondly, you have to put them at scale. And thirdly, also to take into account the financial side. Again, we have to do a sustainable business. But I really believe that in the following years, we will have some very interesting innovations. And inside Kering, and I will stop by that, we created in 2013 the Material Innovation Lab based in Italy. It's a kind of hub where we have at the same time a library with now more than 4,000 sustainable fabrics. But they also support our suppliers inside our supply chain to push innovation that we will be able to put in our next collections. And on the other side, for our watches and jewelry sector, we created now in 2020 what we call the Sustainable Innovation Lab. It's exactly the same approach, but for our jewelry brands like Boucheron, Kéline, Pomellato. We believe a lot that innovation will be part of the journey of sustainability. So first, you put at scale all the best practices. You try to be the most efficient as possible, but we are very conscious that it's not enough. So we need innovation.
I agree with innovation being, I think it's one of sustainability's best partners. And I think it's great what you said about scalability, because in all my years of sort of in sustainability and going to a lot of trade shows and speaking to a lot of very interesting startups, one thing I've noticed is that there are so many great ideas out there, but at the end of the day, for a business your size, scalability is truly something that is super important, because many of these interesting ideas, they might be sustainable on a small scale, but once you start mass producing, even if it's the same cactus or, you know, certain materials, they might actually again become a sustainability problem. So scalability can be quite tricky in this
part. It's key because if you have a pilot project, it's great. also linked with communication. You can do communication, you can have beautiful speeches, but you don't change in depth your business model. And what we have to change, it's really the business model. We have to reduce in absolute value our greenhouse gas emission. We have to transform the agriculture in a more regenerative way. So we have many, many, many challenges. And to do that, it's a question of scalability and to be sure that the pilot project, one day you will be able to put at scale and really to transform your supply chain, your processes, and at the end, I hope, because we open source, our entire industry. We want to push.
Yeah, and this is where the, you know, the greenwashing thing comes in, because you can see that when you're not just implementing it, like you said, for one special edition of a little thing made out of a specific material that can't be scaled, you understand that's greenwashing. But when you do it on a bigger scale, that is genuine change.
Exactly, exactly. And so that's why also I mentioned the Fashion Pact. But we are doing really the same thing for the watch and jewelry sector. And we created also a coalition, Watch and Jewelry Initiative for 2013. We did that with Cartier now nearly 2 years ago to have the same approach. We need to have volume. We need to change our industry. And of course, we can't do the thing alone. But to come back to your point about plastic and how much plastic is key when we are speaking about pollution and above all, pollution inside the oceans. It's one of our pillars in the Fashion Pact. We have three pillars. The first, it's about climate change. The second, it's linked with the protection of biodiversity. And the third, it's really dedicated to ocean, and we have a specific focus on plastic. If I come back at the level of caring, even if the exact figures have yet to be established, we know that, of course, the textile industry has its part of responsibility. After, depending where you are in the fashion industry, of course, your impact, it's not the same. For me, we have to fight, I will say, three dimensions. We need to work both on eliminating what we can call toxic chemical use. We have, secondly, to tackle microfibers. And we have also to tackle microplastic from our processes. You know, I am an engineer, so I like the target, the calendar, and everything. So that's why we decided to be free for all B2C plastic by 2023. Okay, so it's one of our targets. We want to be single-use plastic free by 2025. And we want really to eliminate microfiber by 2030. So we have three levels of targets. To do that, of course, we take every step of our processes. We try really to have a clear cartography where our single plastic is used, how we can remove it. But we want also, because for us it's key, really to involve our suppliers. And we ask to our suppliers really to implement sustainable principles, which are quite technical, because we ask them, for example, to use dyeing, finishing processes that preserve fiber, yarn. And you know, it's really important to preserve the strength of the fiber yarn, because for after, it's reduced the risk to find something in the ocean or in the water. So we go in a different kind of technical processes. When we are thinking about how we can remove polybags, because you know also in our industry, polybags, we are using polybags. We are doing research through also the Fashion Pact with other companies, really to find a new raw materials with the same quality, because one of the big advantages for plastic is the fact that it's transparent. So you have also to find the same quality of raw materials that, of course, with less impact. So it's really somewhere where we want to dedicate time, where we want to dedicate also money to find innovative solutions, and again to have really an open source approach, because plastic, it's plastic, microfiber, microplastics, and also chemical products are big, I won't use challenges this time, but really issues.
Yeah, I think a lot of people still don't realize that synthetic clothing actually sheds microplastics as well. And they often, when they think of the plastic problem, they sort of just limit it to plastic bags, plastic straws. But actually, the fashion industry is a huge contributor to this problem as well. So it's great to hear that.
In luxury, and again, but I don't want to, I will say, flag one sector in the textile industry in comparison with another sector. But again, in luxury, we are using a lot of natural fibers. And to react about what you were saying, synthetic fibers, plastic fibers, or this kind of thing, they really represent a very small quantity. I don't say that we are not using at all. It's not my point. But in comparison with natural fiber, it's nearly nothing. It's very interesting to really have this conversation, because you share not only your commitments, but a great experience also, how your community is reacting through your NGO where you are ambassador. You have an overview. But could you share a little bit, what is your vision about the tomorrow luxury? How do you see luxury for the future?
I think when luxury comes to my mind, the first thing I can think of is people want to be able to splurge without feeling guilty. And I think that's sort of what luxury is meant to bring. It solves your problem of, I don't know, questions about ethics, about sustainability. It gives you this product at a higher margin, but that you know for sure has all this transparency and has been vetted behind it. So I definitely think the luxury of tomorrow is 100% transparency. It is a product where people don't have to keep asking questions. They don't have to keep being worried about their consumption. And this is something I personally am not yet so involved, but you know, I do admit that everything to do with the metaverse and sort of the digital fashion, and maybe I ask you now about that, because I know that Kering actually has done quite a few interesting projects, and a lot of people are saying maybe this can be the solution for the future of fashion. What do you think?
It's a big question. It's true that inside the Kering Group, and thanks to our brands, we are at the same time taking into account sustainability, but we are also convinced that digital is very important for the future, and it's also a big part of our development. If I only answer with my hat of Chief Sustainability Officer, I think as soon as you develop something, a new technology, a new way to have a conversation with your customers, to sell some products, you have always to pay attention about your environmental footprint. So same thing, you can develop digital, you can go to the metaverse world, you can use what you want, but you have to be conscious that you have an environmental footprint, you emit greenhouse gas emissions, so if you do that, you have to reduce in another place or in another way. But you can't only say, okay, I add some greenhouse gas emission here and on the other side. So it's not possible, because at the end of the day, you have to reduce in absolute value your greenhouse gas emission. You have to reduce your footprint on biodiversity. So it's a question of equilibrium. And so that's why I come back to my tool EPNL. It's very important to have an overview with a lot of details about your environmental footprint, to be conscious that, okay, I can increase on this side, but I have to decrease a lot on the other side. So for me, it's really important to think in this way.
Now, a more of a fun question. If you could have a magic wand to change something in the world, anything, what would you change?
If I have a magic wand, I will answer with a personal point of view. For me, no animals suffer from human ants. And for you, if you have a magic wand, what it will be?
I think for me it would be changing human nature as it is, and specifically the part of humans wanting more. Throughout history, we've wanted more lands, more power, more wealth, more resources, and I don't see that changing without us changing as beings. A bit more philosophical.
Very ambitious, very impressed. A big thank you, Duana, for this conversation. It was really great, an amazing time with you. Thank you for sharing your passion, your commitments, and it was a real pleasure. And I'm sure that it's a beginning of other conversations. So thank you so much.
Thank you for the great conversation.